My friends, I ask you, where have you seen this before? Yes, it's another Martin guitar. It's a D28. According to the paper, it's a 1971. And I'm going to tell you what we're going to do to it right after this. Friends, Jerry Rosa here in the Rosa Stringworks Workshop. Yes, we have another classic Martin D28, and this one does have some issues. It needs a good setup is really what it boils down to, and we're going to do a little other work, like we're going to get rid of the pickup, and we're going to put in a new antler saddle, those kinds of things. So let me play it for you right now and show you what some of the problems are. One of the problems you can probably hear right away, listen to this. Can you hear that buzz? It's buzzing on the first fret, I believe. Not too bad after that. And then I also hear noise or a muted sound on the B string. Just kind of dull like, muted like. Terrible. It probably picks up okay on the camera, but in real life it's dull. Yeah, and like that E string is dull when I'm noting that on the G chord there. Well, I think we've got a lot of good improvement we can make on this. I'm pretty sure we're going to crisp up the sound and make it sound like a real guitar. We need to file through the hump right in here. There's a pretty good hump right here at the neck joint, which is not uncommon. This does not have an adjustable truss rod, so we're going to need to do a little bit more filing. Let me just check what the before action is. It does look a little high, although it may not be that bad. Honestly, it looks a little bit high. Yeah, it is quite a bit high, actually. It's about 112 thousandths, so that's pretty high. We'll get that down to around 90 anyway, so that'll make it a lot better. This side's not bad. This side's, you know, I don't know, 85, 90, so it's about right on that side. But I guess they've got it extra high because of this hump through here, and it buzzes when you get up in this area, apparently. So we're going to fix all that, and we're going to get started right now. Well, since this is in for a real good setup, I want to check the bridge plate and all that, too, just to make sure that that looks good. So let me look in there and see. Oh, it looks real nice. I do see, in fact, it's in very good shape. It is a hardwood bridge pad like I put in my instruments. It is I'm going to say it's rosewood. That's what I would say it looks like. I think it's funny that sometimes you'll find rosewood, sometimes you'll find maple, etc. But rosewood is by far superior to a maple or a plywood bridge pad. You know, I've always said, you know, this is where it counts on your setup. This is where the music comes from. You don't ever cheap out in this area. So when they have a rosewood bridge pad, you know you've got something of quality there. And this is a good rosewood bridge on top of that. Or maybe that's an ebony bridge. I guess it is ebony. I can see grain patterns in it. It makes me think it's rosewood, but I suppose that is ebony. But anyway, the point is that it's good quality material in this area, and that's what you want. And there's no tear out in the holes, so they all look real good. So the next thing we're going to do is start removing the pickup, I think. So we've got to get the saddle out, and I think it's got an under-saddle pickup based on the wire I see in there. And it looks like it's stuck pretty good. No, it's coming out. I don't know if this is one of those attached to the bridge or... Yes, it is, actually. Or at least it's stuck to it. I don't know if it's supposed to be stuck to it. But it is stuck to it. I don't think that's supposed to be stuck there. I really don't think it's intended to be stuck. It just is stuck. Yeah, there it came apart. Yeah, I think that just got stuck on natural causes, if you will. That's not supposed to be stuck like that, I don't think. And I don't think that's going to go down through that hole, so I'm going to have to probably unsolder this to get it apart. So I'll do some disassembly on the back end back here, and I'll show you the next step. I took the screw off. I did notice that when they drilled it out, they chipped out the rosewood right there. That's kind of a shame. But anyway, we'll do what we can to improve all that. If we can find a way to fix that, we'll fix that too. I'm trying to pull the pickup out. It's a little tight, but it's coming. I got it. And so it's just the one wire straight to this. There's no batteries or anything like that in this case. Let me see if this will unscrew or if I have to undo the whole thing. Yep, the whole thing comes off. And we will just unsolder it. That will be the easiest way to get it out without damaging the pickup. Okay, we've got the soldering gun out here, and I'm just going to heat this up. I love these soldering guns. They get hot fast like this, and doesn't take very long at all. You're in business. So pull that alpha there, if it'll come off. I think it's off. Oh, there's another soldering there. I see that now. I was wondering why it didn't pull off, but there's another one here I got to get loose. There it is. There we go. We got it loose now. And now it should pull out through the hole here. And it did. And what we'll do is we'll put this back together and give it and put it in the case so the customer can reuse it again down the road. Okay, now that the pickup is out, we're going to level through and recrown all these frets and everything. You can tell these frets are pretty old. Look at they're just kind of got a patina on them, if you will. They've been that way for a long time, but we're going to make them look just about like brand new again. I've also noticed that the peg head here has got that kind of a patina look to it too, and we're going to clean all that up and buff that out too. So it's going to look really nice when we're done. Let's get started. All right, I'm going to first just kind of see where I feel it start to rock. Actually, right there is where I'm feeling it rock a little bit. Right here a little bit too. So it's a little bit unflat in several places. I think I'm hitting them all pretty good, but I thought I'd stop and show you this. You can see right here that crusty part right there has not been touched yet. So that was much lower than everything else. Just as an example there, that's the kind of thing you look for when you're doing a fret job. So this is low, this is low, this is low. So it's just a low spot through there. And we're going to just clean that up. I scrape a living from the soul. Like my father before me. Now if you look at it, you can see just the least little bit there that's not filed. These are cleaned up, so just a little bit more and it'll be fine. I labor and toil, but my father said, son, you should move away. Now I'm going to take off the corners. Farm life is dying, son, please don't stay. I moved to the city. I keep my finger under there so I don't accidentally come down and hit the top. Keep my thumb under it on this side. Yeah, those ends were protruding just a little bit. Not too bad. Okay, that's pretty good. Everything looks pretty level. There's still one little tiny string groove that I can see right here, and it's almost disappearing. I like to go to the point where they just about disappear. This has got to go just a hair more, and then we're done. And it tried to fit in. That's pretty good. That just barely, I can almost tell where it was. It's pretty much gone at this point, but that's good. And that's just about where you want to stop. You don't want to keep going after you get to that point. That way you're removing the minimum amount you can remove and still do a good job on your frets there. Okay. So that's really nice. Now what we're going to do is recrown them all. You'll notice as I recrown, I roll it like this because I'm not wanting to take anything off the top. I'm trying to knock these sharp corners off, and that's all I want. You do have to be careful when you roll it because you can push off and hit and scratch your fretboard. And then I try to round these ends like this. And that really does a nice job. You can't even feel them that way after you're done with that.
Heard how the crops would get in. I could hear him say, "Son, you should move away." He said, "Farm life is dying."
Well, that looks pretty darn good to me, so I think that's going to be fine. And I don't feel anything, so that feels good. So let's get some 600 sandpaper now, and we'll smooth that up. Actually, we're going to use 800, and this was provided by Rick Ward, one of my wonderful viewers. Thank you very much, Rick. And we just cut out a little patch about that big is all we need. As I always do, I go this way to make it faster, and it also rounds them off better. It really does, believe what you want, but it really rounds them off better. It doesn't leave any scratches because it's 800 grit, folks. In case you don't know what 800 grit means, it means you can fit 800 pieces of that sandpaper in a 1 square inch.
Son, please don't stay.
That looks really, really, really smooth. It's just about mirror quality already. But we will go ahead and take it to the mirror quality since we can. I won't need to block the fretboard off this time because I'm going to have to clean the whole fretboard up anyway. There was a little bit of fingernail grooves in here, so I thought I would just scrape the fingerboard anyway, is why I didn't care about going this direction. It doesn't hurt anything. So now I will go ahead and polish these out to a just like a mirror-like finish. Just a little bit of polish, this semi-chrome polish is what I'm using. And you just rub it back and forth on the fret like this. And you just keep going back and forth. And it doesn't take very long at all. That's real time right there. And I think it's going to be perfectly polished out already. So I'll just show you what that first fret looks like. And so there's the first fret polished. I think you can see it compared to the others. And I'll just go ahead and do the rest of them here. In fact, I'll just do them off camera and show you what it looks like when I'm done. Well, there you go. That's what they look like, all polished up like a mirror. And they're pretty darn shiny, I think you can see. That should take care of that part. Now, what I do is do a fretboard leveling. And I use my thick razor blades. You can get these off the products I use page on my website. In fact, that metal polish is on there also, semi-chrome. I have a lot of products listed on my website, products I use page. And in fact, there's a lot of helpful tips on that too. So if you go down through there and read all that, it might be of a benefit to you. So now I'll just take and scrape this out. As I mentioned, these are heavier razor blades than your average. These are like 12 thousandths thick versus the standard 8 or 9. I just go until I see all the marks disappear. You can even scrape the purl level and keep the purl level with this. Does a good job.
I return for a visit, but I was too late. My father.
Once I get all of the fretboard cleaned up like that, then I go back through and put the sharp edge right against the fret on both sides of every fret and scrape across. I don't know if you can see how much is coming off there, but there's a lot. So that's why you want to clean this all up right next to your fret. And I'll do both sides. I do one side and then I flip the guitar around. It's easier for me. I always find it easier to draw it to me and have my thumb there to stop it, so I don't scratch anything by accident.
Dying, I knew it was vain. But he turned and said, son.
That's all there is to that. Then I just clean it off. And now we will just oil the fretboard. And for the oil, we will use the Be Good oil again. Boiled linseed oil would be just perfectly fine, and you just want to make sure you wipe it completely back off. Doesn't take very much. A few drops like that is all you'll need, and that's more than enough. Then you can just work it in. I like to roll it around like this so that I get it in under the frets everywhere. It gets in there really good. And I've got more than I need, so might as well just rub it on the bridge while I'm at it, you know? Someone has replaced the pick guard on this, and unfortunately it's a little small. It didn't quite match the original. I'll look and see if I have a better pick guard. If I do, I'll put it on, because this really is quite small. I don't know if it shows up in the camera, but you can see how it doesn't come up to where it should here and here and right here. So it's quite off. But if I've got one, I'll fix it. If I don't, I'll leave it alone. I say don't fix it if it ain't broke. Well, in my mind, that's kind of broke. It's just not the way it should be. So if I can fix it, I will. And now I'm just going to clean off this oil. And you can see there, it kind of collects a lot of dirt and everything while you're doing this too. A lot of staining, I guess you'd say, more than dirt, really. So I got most of it back off. Get the rest of it off here. And in fact, I'll take a dry clean cloth now and finish it up. So here's a dry clean cloth, and we'll finish it up with that. And we'll get down on the edges too. And we'll wipe off the bridge one more time too. That really makes a nice job out of it. That fretboard looks almost brand new now. And I'm gonna go look and see if I have a pick guard real quick. Well, the only one I have that actually fits it is the brown one, and that would change the looks altogether, so I'm not gonna do that. My black one is actually close to the right shape, but it's small too. This one's not even really the right shape in my opinion. The one that's on there, because I'm exaggerating, but this is coming out at an angle like this instead of going back straight in like it should have. So I don't have one that's going to be any better, so I'm just not going to worry with that. I think I'm going to take this over to the buffer and just buff it out. It's not bad, but it can sure be a lot better, and I think that'd make it look nice, and this old guitar deserves that after this many years. I've got my Stuart McDonald grinder here that I built this pedestal for it and all that. It was kind of a kit. I only use the dark compound on this. The lighter compound is a finer polish, but I find that this does a good job and does it a little bit faster. So that's all I use. there's just the bottom half right in this area here is all that I've polished so far compared to this side. You can see quite a difference. So I'll just go ahead and polish the rest of it and show you what it looks like when I'm done. Well, that's about as good as you can do on a buffer like that. Now I'll do some more by hand. Now that we've got it all buffed out, I thought I'd go ahead and top off at least the top and the back with a good coat of Renaissance wax. Might do the sides too, but for sure it helps your sound if you do your top and your back. It crisps up that finish, gives you a good crisp sound. It really does do a good job, not to mention protection and all that. Now with most paste waxes, I would say you wouldn't even want to put on this much. You know, I'm just doing, you know, about 2/3 of this top right now. But with most paste waxes, I would recommend you only do about 1/4 of it at a time because they're so hard to get off. This paste wax is not easy to get off because it takes some elbow grease, but it's much easier than most paste waxes that are available on the market. It still takes elbow grease though, and you need to keep your rag turning constantly to get it all off. And it's not even a bad idea to use a fresh rag. That towel already had a little bit of stuff on it, so I'm going to just take a clean towel here and start fresh on this, and that'll get it off and get it really nice. Yep, that looks good. If you can't get it off, then your best bet is to put some more back on and then take it off. That's your best bet. I think you can see how shiny that is. Now I'm going to do the rest of this up here. And when you put it on, you kind of rub it in pretty good too. You don't just wipe it on lightly. You kind of give a little bit of pressure with that. Yeah, I know people like to use those spray polishes because they're so simple, but I really don't recommend the spray polishes at all because they will eventually corrode your plastics, shrink your plastics up. More than likely, that's what happened to this pick guard. That's what I bet on, almost guarantee you. It was probably a chemical reaction to finishes or polishes that were put on it. You notice I did not put the wax on top of the pick guard, and I never do, even though this wax is probably the safest wax you could put on there. I still don't do it. All right, so now we're gonna wax the back. There's some pretty good scratches in a place or two here, so I'm gonna try rubbing them out a little bit. I don't know if they'll come out at all or not. I doubt it.
I scrape a living from the soul, like my father before me. I labor and toil.
You don't want to let it dry. You want to get it right back off as quick as you can, pretty much. Keep your rag turning over to get a fresh surface on there all the time to get that wax off, because that wax does not like to come off. Paste waxes are difficult to take off. That's why people use the liquid polishes, because they're so simple. But you don't get near the job that you get with the paste wax. And I mean in terms of protection or sound, and you run the risk of spoiling your plastics with the liquid polishes because they have chemicals in them. Keep those rags turning like this. That's what makes it come off, because if you know, once the rag gets a little bit of polish on it, it won't take the other polish off very easy. That's pretty good. You have to look at different lights to see it all. A lot of times it'll still be there and you can't see it. So now that I've got it all cleaned off, I think I'll just take one more dry cloth, wipe it down one more time real good. I think that's good enough. I'm not going to do the sides and everything because it's so labor intensive, and the top and the back is what really gives you your best sound. So I'm just going to go with that and we'll move on to the next step. Well, I think I will do the peg head. I got to thinking about it, and I think this peg head needs a little bit of something. Not that much. It won't take that much to do it either, so I'm just going to wipe it down a little bit. It looks much better. Yeah, it looks a lot better than it did. So, anyway, we're about ready to start putting strings on this, but first, I have to make a new saddle, so we'll get that made right now. Okay, I've got a rough piece of deer antler here, and I've just took it over to the belt sander, and I just sanded one flat spot in it. You try to find the spot that's the flattest on the antler, and then just sand it flat, and then you hope you have enough thickness here before it gets porous to make your saddle out of, and I think I do here. And, you know, we're only going to be using that much of it, so I think we'll be fine. Now, and then when I get that flat spot, then I take it and I lay it on the disc sander, and I put a 90 degree on this. And this doesn't have to be flat. I just want it to sit flat on my table, like that. So it now sits flat against my fence, and I'm going to slice off a piece, and I'm going to slice off a piece that's about twice as wide as I need, or twice as thick as I need. So here we go. This is starting to get into the porous part on the thick piece, and you can see we pretty much removed all the porosity here. That there is probably just more coloration than it is porosity. So we just hit right on the right spot there, and it's going to be just fine to make a saddle out of this. So let's go over and do the next step. For me, the next step is setting the sander to the right thickness. And what I do is I keep turning the table up until I can feel this, you know, kind of grabbing on the sandpaper. And it's getting close. Right about there. That's pretty good. Just a hair more. And then I've already sanded the ends flat so that I can push it through. And I'll turn on my dust collector. So the dust collector's on, and now we'll turn on the sander. And then what we have to do is start measuring the thickness to get it to the proper thickness. Now this saddle is the one that came out of there, and it was a pretty good fit. So I'm planning to use this saddle for my gauge, but I'm going to add about 5 thousandths just to play it safe. This says 88 thousandths, so actually I'll just go up to 95. I'll just make mine 95 thousandths, and then we know we're going to be plenty thick. The day I met her on the mountain in the fall. Okay, 95 thousandths was what we were shooting for. There's 95.5, so it's a half a thousandths too thick. That's close enough. All right, so now we've got a good flat spot there, and now what we'll do is we'll trace this out, except that we want to leave more because this was sitting on a pickup. We're going to want to add the thickness of the pickup on this when we make this. But what I'm going to do first is just put a straight line across here, and then I'll show you how I add the thickness. All right, you can probably see I've drawn a straight line across this, and I'm just going to saw that straight line off by hand. Now that I have that sawn straight off, I'll go over to my belt sander and just make sure this is perfectly flat and square. Okay, now that I have a flat spot sanded on here, and I can lay it on my real good flat table and see that it matches really well, then I'll lay something here for a spacer and put that on top, and then I'll take the original saddle and I'll lay it on top of here, on top of that spacer, which kind of acts like it's the... the pickup is what that spacer does. So that'll give me a taller saddle then when I create this. And that's okay. I mean, I know I'll probably be way too tall, but I'd rather be way too tall than not tall enough. So there you go. You've got it all marked out. Now all I gotta do is saw that out.
Come springtime,
now that we have the saddle roughed out, I'll take it over to another sander and we'll clean that up. The process on this is I'm going to put an angle on the back side of this saddle, and I'm also going to round off the corners. Well, that looks good on that part. Now we'll come back over to the bigger disc sander, and I'll just round the ends and square the ends off. Now, with any luck at all, we should be too big in pretty much every dimension. So it's probably too wide to fit down in here, and that's okay. I'm good with that. It's probably too long, I'm hoping anyway, because I didn't cut it off short. Although the length looks like it's going to be really close. I don't think I'm too short, but it's going to be very close on the length. I think we're going to be just about perfect on the length. So I'm glad I left it long, because it would have been ugly otherwise. And we should be too tall this way too. But right now, because we're too thick, I'm going to go over and take a little bit off of this, because the original was 88,000. So I'm going to take this down to about 90 and see where we're at. Well, like I say, I always like to sneak up on it. 92,000 almost wants to go in there, but it won't. So we'll try 90. Oh, I missed my mark. Instead of 90, I hit 89,000. So, I took a thousandth off too much, but the original was 88. So we may still be too tight, because the original was a good fit. And I mean, we're starting to go down in there, but it's not a perfect fit yet. So I'm going to go run it back through there one more time. Well, I don't know what the difference is. I've never had this happen before. This says 88 thousandths right there, as you can see. I put this in here. It says 88 thousandths, as you can see. This doesn't go in there. Well, I mean, I guess I could force it, but boy, it wants to go in tighter than that 88 thousandths. So this must be 88 thousandths and a couple of tenths, because this one goes in there without too much trouble. But this one doesn't. Yeah, now that's crazy. So this must just be, it must be the guesstimator part of this where we're at in the tens of thousands of inches is the difference. But it does measure 88, as you can see. And so does the other one, plain as day. Well, this one's, yeah, plain as day. So this one's got to be just a fraction bigger. So I may run it through there one more time without changing any of the settings and see if that does it. Well, that did it. It just went straight down in there. And it's a super tight fit, I will say that. Let me just show you here. I can pick up the whole instrument with that. It's a nice super tight fit, and yet it doesn't, it's not in there so tight you can't get it out. I think we're going to be quite high, almost positive of that, but I'm still going to go ahead and put the two strings on it and test it. In this case, the customer is supplying the strings. I have the exact same strings that I would have put on here. In fact, that's the choice I would have made. These are the J16s, so these are the lights. That's the perfect fit, I think, for a Martin guitar. I know a lot of people swear by the, mediums, but I'm telling you what, when you set them up right and, you polish them up and clean them up like I've done this one, you're going to be amazed at how this sounds with light strings. It will sound just fine. The old myth about you have to have medium strings on a Martin guitar is just a myth. It goes back a long way, and it's hard to change people's opinions. But it's wrong. I know this is going to be way high, so that's just a given. All we're doing right now is just deciding how much to take off the saddle. So I have to put the two E-strings on to do that. Okay, those two strings are in place. Now we'll tune them to pitch. Even though you don't absolutely have to, I just think you get a little better reading when you tune them up to pitch. You, but I can already tell that's cleaner sound, even though it's too high. Okay, that's close enough to just check the action. And we'll pull out our gauge here. This gauge is available on the Products I Use page as well. This is going to be crazy high, I know that already. Yeah, it's at 137. I'm going to call it 137, so I'm going to write that down. So 137 on the bass, and let's see where we're at on here. I'm going to call it 116 on the treble. Now we're going to do some math and figure out what we're going to do with that. So it's 47. In order to drop it 47 thousandths here, we have to double that back here, which is crazy. So that's, what, 94 thousandths? That's a lot to take off. So I got to minus 94 thousandths off of there. All right, so 116, and we want to get down to 80, so that is 36 thousandths. As we double that, that's 72. We've got to minus off 72 on the treble side. That's a lot to take off, but I think we've got it there to remove, so we should be okay. Okay, what I do is I've made a black mark on both ends, as you can see, and on the bass end, I got to set it to 94 thousandths. So I'll just pull this down to 94,000. Then I'll scratch that mark right here. And you can see the little white mark there probably. And then I'm going to set it to 72,000ths on the other side. I'll scratch that mark. And we've got that mark. So now all I do is I just push this into the sander till those marks touch. Well, I'll be honest with you, I'm a little scared because this just barely is taller than the original one now. So I hope that pickup was thinner than I was expecting, because otherwise we got problems. And I would say at this point we got problems, because this doesn't look good. But let's test it and see, because you never know till you know. So I have a feeling this is going to be too low. My guess is that this saddle wasn't down in there deep enough or something, and I was pushing for all I was worth and it just wouldn't go any deeper, but I don't know. We'll see. Well, as of right now, that's working just fine. The only negative is that there's not much angle from the pin back up to the saddle, and this is pretty thick, and the only other option we would have would be to do a neck reset. And the neck reset, this doesn't need a neck reset, but it's on the edge. I would say just reduce this a little bit, to get a little bit more angle, and we're good to go. That's way better and way cheaper, and it'll last a long, long, long time by just doing that. And that's what I'm going to do. So what I'm going to do is actually take off a little bit of this. I'm going to use the finger plane here. I'm mostly going to work on the back side, a little bit on the front side, but not much on the front. It's mostly going to be on the back side. And I'm not taking off that much. Probably looks a lot worse than it is. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is take a razor blade and scrape that smooth.
Our love grew the summer long.
It looks real nice. Now I'll get the 220 sandpaper out. By the way, this is still a really thick bridge. It's even thicker than, say, average. So we didn't create any problem. When I say thick, I mean tall from the base here. It's thick this way, if that makes any sense to you. That looks really good. Now what I'm going to do is get the Dremel tool and cut a little bit of a string groove there up to the saddle so that it'll have enough angle. Once again, it doesn't need much at all.
Little did I know, my sweet Melinda, once you're dear, she would be.
Quite honestly, I wish I would have put a little bit more bevel on this before I did that groove. I'm going to try it and see how this is going to go. This could create a problem. I hope it doesn't. It looks like it's going to be fine. It looks pretty good. I think that'll be just fine. Okay, well, let's go ahead and get the strings on this thing. I'm going to oil this first. Let me get the oil back on there, and then we'll get the strings back on here and see what it looks like. So there you go. It looks just fine. You can't tell we did anything to it, really. And let's get this new saddle back in there. That looks better. There's just enough clearance now that it looks just good. These pins have already been beveled a little bit. I would probably bevel them more, but they've got enough that it should be fine. Probably wouldn't hurt anything if this one had bone pins in it. I'm not so sure everybody can hear the difference on the bone pins versus the plastic pins. I think I could probably hear it, but I'd say, you know, your average musician, I have a feeling, wouldn't notice the difference. It doesn't make a huge difference, but if you're somebody that's a real fun picker and player and you want to get everything out of your instrument, then you'd probably want to put the bone pins in this. I'll show you what it looks like when I get the strings on it. Okay, the strings are on it. Let's see where we landed on the action. I'm hoping it's good. Well, I'll be honest, it's a little bit more than I was hoping. On the bass side, it's 100 and... might be 115. That's kind of high still. And on this side, we're at about 85, so that's pretty good on this side. Not too bad there. Let's just see, before we go any further, let's just see what it's like at the nut, because the nut could be real high too. And if it is, that would affect it a little bit. It won't affect it a lot, but it'll affect it some. Yeah, the nut's a little bit high, so we can take this down just a little bit, and we'll do that. Plus, it'll give me a chance to make sure that angle is right, and I don't even think it is, because that's what I think I'm hearing some notes here. I'm also seeing that the strings are riding up on the sides, and that's not good. So the strings grooves are too tight, and I'm angling this down and going to get the string riding on the bottom of the nut here, and I'm going to check it before I go any deeper. I haven't really gone any deeper yet. Okay, that's pretty close. Doesn't have to be perfect. And yeah, it's almost there. Boy, I mean, it's really close. We're going to take it down just a little tiny bit more. That's just about perfect. Actually, that one's already good. This one's a little bit high. This one's a little high. This one's about right. So I can take these two down just a tiny bit too. I was kind of hoping they'd be higher than that, honestly, because that would give me a little bit more to play with. But it looks like we're going to have to do some extra work. I can tell they're not cut at the right angle, though. That's probably what's causing some of this weird sound that I'm hearing. I think that helped that one already. We can still go down just a tiny bit. Yeah, that's just about right there. Yeah, it's lifting the string just a little bit, and that's what you want. This one here is not lifting the string at all, so we'll go with this one next. And again, I don't think it's cut at the right angle based on what I can see down in the slot. If you look at the slots, it'll tell you a lot. You can see dark spots in there, and wherever you see the dark spot, that's where it's either riding or vibrating. Still not lifting the string, so that's my test. If it's not lifting the 16,000th pick, it's too high. Yeah, it's lifting it now, just barely. I think we'll call that good enough, because we're going to drop it back here a little bit more, I think. Let me double check this back here. Yeah, we're close to 103. I'm going to say 103 is what I'm going to say it is now. Let's see what this one is here. Is honestly, this one's pretty good. It's right at 80. So 80 is pretty good. We could afford to drop it a hair there, but not much more than a hair. So I'll just write 80 there. All right, I want to get this down to 90. So that's 13 thousandths. So that's 26 thousandths off of this side to basically nothing. So that's what we want to do, 26 thousandths down to nothing. Now that I have to drop the saddle some more, I think I'm going to take this down just a hair more. Not very much, but, you know, enough to make the difference, because it's just a hair high. And I'm just going to do it with the scraper.
My sweet Melinda of the mountain.
I'm even going to touch that up with a little bit of 320 after the 220. I think it'll just make it look that much better. I think that looks real nice and really smooth. So now I'm going to put a drop of oil on this again. Doesn't take much at all. All right, so now I'll mark the saddle for what we need to take off and be right back with you. Well, I took the saddle back down some more, and it's a really small saddle, I'll have to say that. Off camera, I also checked the depth to make sure I was going full depth, because I was beginning to worry about that. But it seems like it's going in there just fine, and it's at full depth. And we've got just enough, I think, to create a decent angle. So let's string it up again and see what happens. Well, my friends, it's all set up. I need to check the tuning. And it took me exactly 3 hours and 18 minutes to do that setup. Now that includes buffing it out and all the other things I did to it. So that's pretty darn good. plays like butter right now. Let's just double check the setup on it and just to see where we're at, because I haven't checked it yet. I just assume that it's going to be right, because when you get down to that final detail, it usually is. So let's see. Landed right on 89 on that side, and a little less on this side. Let's see. I'd say about 75 on that side. So that's just about as perfect as you could ever want a setup to be, I think. So let's play it for you and see what it sounds like. It's dull. Got a very good sound now, nice and clear and crisp. You know, there's no weird funky sounds going on like there was before. And the bass string doesn't vibrate when you hit it, even though, you know, if anything, I lowered the nut up here on the bass string. So, I mean, you know, you got to take that into consideration too. Fret job means a lot. Yeah, it's very, very nice.
I can't be your fool anymore, darling. It's just not right to treat my heart this way. If I stay,
my bet is since 1971, that's the best this has ever been set up. That's just my bet. You know what? Got to thinking about this, and I didn't fill that in. I didn't ask him if he wanted me to do that, but I think I'll do that, and I'll show you what that looks like too. What I think I'm going to do, I made this pin that fits it pretty good. And I'm just going to put regular old tight bond on it and smear that around a little bit. And then we'll slide that in there. And I think that's going to go all the way flush once I tap it. I've got my plastic hammer here. Yep, that went real nice and flush. Clean off the extra glue there. The other thing I noticed, you know, remember we talked about they had a chip out there, so I think what I'll do is fill that chip out with just a little filler. It's not my favorite way to do it, but it's the most practical way in a case like this. So we'll just take a little bit of filler in there and fill in this chip out. And then we'll just dye that to match. This plug has got a little bit burnt on the end. I'll clean that off too, and that white wood will probably match this fairly closely. But I'll give that a little time to dry, I guess. Well, maybe not. I think what I'm thinking of is I could scratch the plug off while I'm waiting for the wood filler to dry and clean the plug off, at least clean the brown off. I think it'll come closer to matching. I don't think it's going to match perfectly. But it's coming off, and it is starting to match. It's not going to match perfectly, I don't think. I was hoping it would lighten up enough to match the other really well. I don't think it's going to matter anyway, because we're going to put a metal pin on here. The metal pin's going to cover 90% of this anyway. I'm not charging him for this, by the way, just so you know. I've already got him off the clock. That's almost dry. I think I'll hit that with the heat gun to dry that up a little bit. Teeny bit of dampness on this, and
wipe over that to filler to just clean it off like that, where it makes it nice and smooth so you don't have to sand it that way. Then I'll just take some of this dark brown stain, tiny bit of it, and I'll put that on the filler. And try just to get the filler, not the guitar at all. And, you know, it's not perfect, but gee whiz, when you're trying to fix something like that, it never is perfect. If it was perfect, it wouldn't be broke. That doesn't look too terribly bad, considering the way it looked before. And now I'll get the strap button and put on there. Since we have a lot of new viewers, you may not have seen me select a drill bit for a screw before, but there's a very black and white way to do this. You take your bit, your drill, and lay it on top of your screw, and you should be able to see threads on both sides, but only threads. And as long as you can see threads on both sides, you've got the perfect size drill for your screw. And that way it won't be too tight and it won't be too loose. So now I have to hold this in a manner that I can drill this as precisely as possible in the center. And that went right through. Now, whenever I put a screw in for the first time, I pretty much, on an instrument at least, I almost always wax the threads. So I've got a little beeswax here and I'm just rubbing it on those threads. And it makes them drive so much better. Of course, it would help if I put the button on there. Whoops. And of course, on camera, you drop it. Where did it go? And of course, on camera, you can't find it either. Oh my goodness. Well, whenever I find that, I'll come back and show you how I install it. And of course, it had to roll in the most complicated place you could imagine, all the way back under my dust collection pipe. My goodness, it's just not easy being me. And anyway, we'll get it in here now. And it's screwing in absolutely like going in like butter. That's what you want though. You don't want them to go in crazy tight. And of course you don't want them crazy loose. And there, it's snugged right up, nice and snug. Nice and snug tight, and that's what you want. So that looks a lot better now without that hole there. Well, that was only a little minor detour. I hope you've enjoyed seeing how I do the detailed setup on a guitar like this. Could this use a neck reset? It's on the borderline, but I don't think it needs one, and I don't think it needs one for a long time yet. So that's why I say do the simple thing, do the easy thing, and you know, I think what we did here, we didn't hurt anything, we didn't lower that enough to matter. Nobody would even be able to tell from the factory that we lowered it, I guarantee you. But it was just enough to make it play well. And so there you go. It'll last a very long time. If you've enjoyed this video, give me a thumbs up. And if you haven't yet subscribed, please do that. I would very much appreciate it. Don't forget to check out the products I use page on my website, www.rosastringworks.com. We'll see you on the next video. Thanks for watching.